So is this the time of the day you would call buonasera, or is it still just buongiorno? Buonasera. 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 As I've mentioned before, I don't speak too much Italian, so it will be English. I'm from the Netherlands, so it's my second language too. My name is Luca Jellema. I'm Oracle Groundbreaker Ambassador, which basically means that sometimes I get invited by Oracle to go to events like this one to talk about the things that I've been doing in my work and make a bit of noise about it and try to get other people to be enthusiastic about it as well. So today we're going to talk about data analytics, specifically about some Oracle Cloud services, in particular Oracle Analytics Cloud. But I'm also talking about the data analytics flow that you go through in general when you try to go from raw data to real insights and anything in between. And Analytics Cloud is one of the services, tools that you could use to help you with that. And it has a desktop counterpart, a tool that looks like the cloud environment, that works like the cloud environment, that works locally. And that's free, or at least I haven't been able to find any way to pay for it, so that must mean it's free. Oracle normally will tell you how to pay for it. But first, I need to tell a story. Oracle Open World and Oracle Code One are conferences that are organized every year in San Francisco. And they're pretty big conferences. And today we have a very nice conference, but it's very small compared to Oracle Open World. And I usually will attend Open World, both as a speaker and as an attendee. I will go to sessions. And then sometimes I don't get to go to the sessions I would like to attend because there are multiple sessions in parallel. And then I would like to be able to download the slides of those sessions afterwards. Or I want to be able to download the slides of the sessions I do attend because I like them and my phone didn't create all those nice pictures I was looking for. But I have a sense that for many of the Oracle presentations at Oracle Open World, especially the ones where they present about roadmap and vision, they don't make the slides available. And that's a yearly frustration. So after last year's Open World, I published this tweet. And it's a bit negative. I'm complaining about the fact that once again, the slides for the Oracle sessions were not available. And it wasn't necessarily a nice thing to do, but I was fed up. And then Grant Ronald replied. He did a session just before this one on Digital Assistant. And basically he said, well, it's a bit harsh, isn't it? We're all working so hard at Oracle and it's not on purpose that we may not have uploaded the slides, but it's by accident. And I felt a little bit bad, but not all that much, to be honest. And there was this whole thread of people chiming in, and some people said, you're right, we want those slides, and others said, we'll be working on it. And then I thought, I don't actually know if Oracle speakers are worse at making the slides available than non-Oracle speakers. So before I make claims like this, let's investigate. Let's dive into the real numbers. So I'm first going to take you through the outcomes. And later on, I'm going to explain how I got to the outcomes. So we're going to see a few details about Oracle Open World and Code One. And for this, we go to the Oracle Analytics Cloud. So now we are live, we are connected to the Oracle Cloud, and we see some details that I gathered from raw data, processed, and eventually turned into the visualizations that you see here. So we've got 2,500 speakers presenting a total of almost 1,700 sessions. Those are the numbers at the top. And down here you can see the number of sessions for each of the two conferences per day. So on Monday there were 400 sessions at Open World and 124 for Code One. So green is open. The big thing is always Open World, and the smaller thing is always Code One, almost always. And here you see how, for the various types of sessions, there's the distribution. So on the far right, there's Code One, That's the smaller part. And almost all Code One sessions were developer sessions, with just a few Birds of a Feather sessions, tutorial sessions. At Open World, the story is quite different. Most sessions are product overview sessions. It's a marketing event, but they don't tell you. Customer case study session, theater sessions, hardly any developer sessions, just a very small portion. So if you're a developer and you're considering to go to Code One, it's probably more interesting. So this is just one of the overviews we can get from Analytics Cloud. And here is a geographic overview. And those of you who know San Francisco probably can tell, although it's a bit hard to see, I'm working on the colors. The largest venue, the venue that, hosts the most sessions, is Moscone West. And it hosts over 400 sessions. People who have been to Java 1, Oracle Open World in the past may remember that the number of venues was much larger. There were more hotels used spread out over the center, downtown San Francisco. But these are the numbers for 2018. These are heat maps, and they are an indication of the number of sessions taking place at any moment in time. On the left, it's by part of the day, so there's afternoon, evening, and morning. And the busiest time of the week is Tuesday afternoon. On the right, it's by hour slot. And the busiest hour slot you can see over here is Monday, 3 p.m. And there's no early start on Thursday, so no slots starting or no session starting at 8, because on Wednesday night, there's a big party at Open World. And of course, no one will show up at 8 a.m. in the morning. And there's a timeline with all the sessions, and I've investigated the first names of the speakers per conference. So at the top is Code One, at the bottom is Oracle Open World, and clearly Michael is the winner. Most speakers are called Mike. That's not entirely true, but the most frequently occurring first name is Michael. There are no female speakers apparently at Code One, and Susan is the most popular female name at Open World. I've used a library to derive the gender of the speakers based on their first name. And that library couldn't decide whether Nitin, Ravi, and Chris are either male or female names. Fair enough. It's not all that interesting, of course. I'm just trying to show off the kinds of things that you can do with Analytics Cloud. Some additional stats that give an insight in how many of the speakers were employed by Oracle and how many are non-Oracle speakers. And when you look at the speakers for Open World, you will see that 50% is Oracle employee, and therefore also 50% is non-Oracle employee. At Code One, no, this can't be right. Sorry, blue is non-Oracle employee. So at Code One, it's 78% is non-Oracle, but for Open World, it's 50-50. At the top, there are the speakers that present at both conferences. And now we get our first glimpse into whether Oracle speakers are more likely to not upload their slides than non-Oracle speakers. This is a correlation matrix. And the only thing I did to create it was to take a number of attributes in my data set and said, put them all in a correlation matrix. Now, when you see a color, it's an indication that these two attributes seem to be moving in the same direction at the same time when it's green, or seem to be moving in opposite directions when it's red. So is there a correlation between the two? And for example, we can see all the green boxes. That's just the combination of an attribute with itself. And of course, there's a huge correlation there, correlation of one. When you look at the pinkish boxes, for example, over here, we see a correlation of minus 0.40, and the values are all between minus 1 and plus 1. So here, apparently, if the speaker has a title, is an Oracle ACE, ACE Director, Java Champion, or Groundbreaker Ambassador, then the chances are that there is not an Oracle speaker involved with the session. The chances are much higher in that case than in the case that there is a speaker who doesn't have a title. Now, when you look at the Oracle session indicator and the file indicator. The file indicator is either 0 if there have no slides been uploaded, or 1 if slides have been uploaded. And we see a very, very slight negative correlation, which means that the chance of the slides not having been uploaded, that chance is slightly higher if the speaker is from Oracle, but only slightly. So I felt a little bit vindicated, but only to a small extent. So the last last visual is going to tell it all. On the left side, we've got the non-Oracle speakers. On the right side, the Oracle speakers. Non-Oracle speakers uploaded 72% of them, 28% didn't, and 29, almost 30% of Oracle speakers didn't upload their slides. So yes, Oracle speakers are sloppier at uploading their slides, but only to a small extent. So maybe I was a bit harsh after all. So that's one thing that Analytics Cloud can do for you. Create those visuals, present those visuals, and share the visuals. And I'm going to talk a little bit about how to get to the visuals. And then we'll also talk about Oracle Data Visualization Desktop, which is the tool that you can run on your laptop, which does exactly the same thing. And to be honest, I have to look very hard to see whether I'm working in desktop or in cloud. Of course, from the browser bar, I could tell, but it's otherwise very similar. So that's in case the cloud didn't work. And in the end, I published this tweet to sort of compromise, be polite about it, at least. So we're talking about turning data, raw data, data from many different sources, into value, into business value, and act on it, for example. So the value of data, and I'm going to tell you some things that you already know. I'm trying to tell it in a structured way, but I'm not going to tell you anything new, I think. So what we would like to have is insight in a state of affairs. How are we doing? What's happening? What are the trends? Are things getting worse? Are they getting better? Are they changing in some way that we should respond to, or are they not changing where we had expected the change? We should know about deviations and exceptions, or at least meaningful deviations and exceptions. That's odd. And sometimes odd is, well, it's just odd. And sometimes odd is, ooh, that's bad, or that's good. We have to know when something's happening that's odd. And we would like to have an understanding of patterns in the things that are happening in our organization. Correlations, causes. If we know about that, we can respond. Or we can make our systems respond. We can apply machine learning and automate the response based on the insight we gain from the data. Now I'm getting ahead of myself. And we also have to be careful that correlation doesn't necessarily mean causation. Yes, things coincide. That does not mean that they have caused each other. This one doesn't really work, I think. Most shark attacks are at the southern hemisphere. And then it's summer, not in July, but in December. It's a nice visual, I thought. And we're working with data from potentially many different sources that provide data in many different formats. It's heterogeneous. It's coming from everywhere. And what we need to do is to cleanse the data, validate the data, filter the data, standardize the data, enrich the data, join the data, make the data workable for our analytics tools. And as any data scientist will tell you, this is the hardest part. Creating a visual isn't hard if you have the data in the right shape. And it's extremely simple. I will show you in a moment. This is the hard part. The data should be interpreted and aggregated to the right level. We are doing a lot of things with IoT, Internet of Things, and with Internet of Things, you tend to have a lot of data. Devices, many devices, sending signals all the time, every few seconds even. And most of those signals are not really meaningful. It's still 21 degrees. It's still 21 degrees. Did I mention it's 21 degrees? And on and on and on. You don't need all those signals, but if you don't actually consolidate the data, you will have them. You will have a lot of data that's for a large part not meaningful. And it should be, in the end, presented in an interpretable form. Here's your data, reams of paper. Here's your data, very big Excel spreadsheet. That doesn't help. That's why we need visualization. And it should be, of course, be published, and it should be accessible at the right time via the optimal channel to the people who need it. probably not people in IT, probably people in the business, whatever that means. And the end result we're trying to achieve is understanding, the ability to take decisions, the ability to take action, to make predictions, to get recommendations, some of it manually, some of it automated. And of course, if we can use all of that to create a better user interface, better experience, systems that will help a user instead of fight a user, then we will create a better user experience and happier users as well. Some nice visuals. The one in the upper left-hand corner is one I took from a documentary series on Netflix on the Vietnam War. Ugly war. And if you have a chance, it's 10 episodes and they last for an hour or longer, so it's a long sit, but it's very interesting. And one of the things that struck me is that war didn't have a real objective. Maybe a very high level objective, but when you looked at the tactical level, it didn't have an objective. So in the end, what the Americans did was just counting the number of people that had died. That became their measure for success. Not because it helped achieve a bigger goal, because it was the only thing they could measure. And that's an easy mistake, to take the things that you can measure, and because you can measure them, think they are important. That's really turning things around. I'm not going to go into a political debate here. So what is new? Because all of I've said so far is something we've done for a long time. We have taken our enterprise database, typically our Oracle database, it's an Oracle event today, and we took data and we did something called ETL, extract, transform, and load, and loaded the data into a data warehouse once a week, once a month, and then we did our reporting and our OLAP analysis, online analytical processing, and our dashboarding against the data warehouse. And this is exactly the thing I've just described. Well, to some extent. This is not a heterogeneous data source. It's a single data source. This is not a continuous process. It's a very batch-oriented process. And of course, then we modernized it and changed the ETL into ELT. When Oracle bought a tool called Synopsys, that's now known as Oracle Data Integrator, ODI, which is now cloud-enabled and called Data Integration Platform. And we had options like materialized views. You probably all know materialized views. And data mining. And maybe not all of you realize that as of 2001, the Oracle database had a data mining engine. And what it does is basically machine learning. Today we call it machine learning. Back then it was called data mining. It's really machine learning. Classification, prediction, linear regression, it's all there. Text analysis, it's all there. It's an extra cost option. It comes with the Oracle database advanced analytics option. So what's new? Well, what is new is the many types of data. Sometimes we call it big data because it's a lot, but also because it's coming from all kinds of sources, at all kinds of speed, the velocity of data. It's coming at web scale, speed of business, coming in real time from the physical world through IoT. So there's more data, there's different types of data, and it's coming much faster. And it's expected of IT to also process the data much faster. And then there's open data. And open data is really a revolution. It means that there's a lot of data available to everyone about what governments are doing, what the state of affairs is in a country, economic affairs, or in healthcare, or many cities publish information about their traffic flows, about the parking situation, about criminal statistics. There's so much more information than we used to have. It's not just our own enterprise information, but it's also information from social platforms and information from government organizations and NGOs. And then, of course, there's the cloud. And what has the cloud done for us? Well, quite a bit, actually. Tooling and scale that used to be available only to the largest of organizations is now available to everyone. Maybe not for months on end, but if we want to do analysis of a rather large data set and it would take 2 weeks, we can just do it in the cloud. We don't have to buy equipment. We don't have to buy software licenses. We can do it in the cloud for a week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, and then let go of it. And I could do it from my laptop. You could do it from your laptop, sitting in the attic, sitting in the garden. The weather is getting a little bit nicer than it is today. And basically the same thing with machine learning. It has been democratized. It has been around for a long time, at least. Some of the machine learning algorithms have been around since the 16th century, and others are more recent. But in the past, they were hard to use. But now we've got so many software libraries that make it extremely simple. And we'll see that Analytics Cloud, for example, also exposes a number of machine learning algorithms in a way that's so simple, my son could do it. I have a lovely son. He's not necessarily very good at IT stuff, but even he could do it. So machine learning definitely has been democratized, and it has been getting fast enough. It's one thing to put in some data and then have to wait for a month to get a result, and then find out whether it's a meaningful result. Now you will get your result much faster. The hardware is there. The algorithms are smart enough. It can be parallelized. We've got Hadoop for very large data sets. So many things have changed. What also has changed, by the way, are the expectations. Our business users, our budget holders, our stakeholders, society, they all expect more from IT. They've seen Minority Report, they've seen many different movies where all kinds of things are done with data. Surely we can do those things as well. So we have to deliver. And it's not so hard as you may think at this moment. So we have this data flow that we go through in order to get from raw data to business insight, business value, if you like. We've got our raw data from various operational sources. Could be in files, could be in the cloud, could be in a REST API, could be in a database, could be in different types of databases, could be on the Hadoop, could be in someone's head. And we need all that data. And through a data pipeline, we get our data into, it used to be called a data warehouse, and now we say data lake. And I think it's at least very similar. Maybe a data warehouse is more structured, is more pre-processed, is more relational database kind of, and data lake is just throw it all together. I'm not sure there's a large distinction. And then from that data lake, we process and select specific subsets of data that we can use for a certain business area, and we call that a data mart. And the process of getting the data and pre-processing it and making it available to our data scientist or our business intelligence person, we call that data wrangling. And I will say a little bit more about the process of data wrangling. In data wrangling, we could be using third-party data sources to do additional enrichment. And I did that in my example when I took the first names of the speakers and derived the gender from it. I did that during data wrangling using a third-party Python library. And you can use machine learning algorithms to help you identify, classify your data, find anomalies. Machine learning is at the far right end of this flow, but it can also help in the middle. And then using that data mart, that pre-processed data, that data that has been optimally prepared for the data scientist to do something useful with, or the business analyst, can be used for visualizations, for dashboarding, for reports. And it can be used for machine learning, typically somewhere in the data science lab, where great, we've got this data and it's all prepared for us. Let's see if we can find a pattern. Let's see if we can find a trend. Let's see if we can create some predictions. Let's see if we can train a meaningful machine learning model. And that's a process of trial and error that may result in absolutely nothing. If it does result in something, we get a trained machine learning model that we can then productize, that we can deploy and make use of in our production systems. This flow, you can go through it one time only. In my analysis of Oracle Open World 2018, I did all of this once. I may do it again for 2019, I don't know yet, but it's, basically one time only. It can be periodic, every week, every month, every quarter, every year, and it can be almost continuous. As soon as new data arrives, we'll take that data and go through the entire flow. Of course, then it has to be automated. When you do it only once, it can just be a largely manual process. And in addition to this flow, we need supporting processes. Master data management, metadata management, data governance, they all revolve around the same thing. We have to understand our data. We have to know what's the truth. If we have customer information in multiple places, which place has the truth? If there are conflicts, how should the conflicts be resolved? If the definition of our data changes over time, it should be managed in data governance so that we know that before last year, this particular attribute contained both street name and house number, but now we've split it and they are different attributes. Maybe it's a stupid example, but you can probably appreciate that sometimes attributes may change meaning or format, and it has to be managed. And very importantly, and something I'm not going to address any further because it's so complex, what about data access authorization, privacy, GDPR? How do you make sure that when there are authorization rules on your data on this end, you apply the same rules on this end? After consolidation and filtering and enrichment and aggregation, what are people allowed to see? That's extremely hard even to think what they should be allowed to see. If I'm not entitled to know each of your incomes, am I entitled to know your average income? I don't know, it's almost an ethical question. Something for politicians, no, ethical question, not politicians. Never mind. Some examples of data sources. Standard applications, your own custom applications, external data sources. This might be the biggest source of data, IoT, web clicks, social media, events. Many different types of data sources. And I'm not going to discuss all of them exhaustively, just that there are many different types of data sources. And we store the data. After we have acquired all the data, we bring it together in a data warehouse or a data lake or whatever we're going to call it. And that has to be implemented in some sort of technology. And what could it be? Well, it could be a database, a relational database or a NoSQL database, probably a combination of all of the above. And that's perfectly fine. And the data pipeline, what do we do? How do we implement it? Well, we could use ETL or ELT tools. We can use streaming event analysis if we're talking about fast data that flows in real time. We could be using scraping to get data from websites, data that's not even published and coming our way, but we are sort of almost stealing from somewhere. And we could use an event bus or even enterprise service bus-like mechanisms, depending on your use case, depending on what you already have in place. And again, it can easily be a combination. All these data flows end up in a data lake, and how each flow in itself is implemented doesn't really matter. Data wrangling. So what about data wrangling? It's a word you may not have heard before. Even the word wrangling you may not have heard before. And apparently wrangling is to round up, to herd, to take charge of, used in connection with livestock. Cowboys were herding, were wrangling. And with data wrangling, it's bringing the data together and then kneading it and shaping it in a way that we need it to be. That's more or less what data wrestling might also be a good term for this. So these are the data wranglers, the real wranglers. Isn't that a brand of jean, Wrangler? Yeah, that's the cowboy connection. Here are some of the activities that we could be doing as part of our data wrangling or data preparation stage. And it's a lot. And it could very well be iteratively. So we have wrangled a bit and we hand it to our data analyst and then they come back to us and they say, that's no good. I need this. Or this is wrong. Or something like that. That typically will happen. Additional algorithms. Machine learning powered algorithms that we could use to enhance our data wrangling. Well, there are some examples there. Sentiment analysis is a popular one. You take a piece of text and you ask the sentiment analysis algorithm, is this positive or is it negative? And then you assign a score, and in doing so, we have enriched our data set. And we can use that score when we create a visualization. Whether that's meaningful, I don't know, but it's something that you could do. And the third-party data sources, especially open data APIs, but many other data sets that are available, some for free and some paid for. DaaS stands for Data as a Service. And there are quite a few DaaS vendors, including Oracle, where you can pay for a subscription on some form of data stream. Could be a news stream or financial data or anything really. And again, a data mart could be stored in various data stores as well. Some of the things we do in the business intelligence stage, creating visualizations, creating notifications, alerting, maybe automated actions, and enforced data authorization. I was not going to mention it again, but well, there it is. Machine learning, what do we do there? Well, there are actually a few types of machine learning. There are machine learning models that someone else already created for us, like speech to text or sentiment analysis. Buonasera. And we can just use them. They are available from the internet through an API, sometimes for free, sometimes you have to pay for them, but we don't have to do any machine learning ourselves in order to benefit from it. So that's your first level of machine learning. And then there is guided training, almost prepared models that we only have to fit our data into and see whether our data will then reveal the ability to forecast or to recommend or to do predictive analytics. That's sort of the holy grail of IoT, is to come up with predictive maintenance. Based on the IoT data, we would like to hear that a machine is about to break down and that we should do maintenance. It's not so simple, but it's what we would like to do. So here we don't have to know a lot about machine learning in order to still be doing it, because some cloud vendor has made a framework available, we bring in our data, and hopefully it will result in a trained model, a model that will do predictions for us. And then, of course, there's also do-it-yourself machine learning, which is hard and is not as magical as some people may want you to believe. Just do it and it will give you power. So that's what happens in the machine learning model step. And once we've done machine learning, and we have a model, let's suppose we have one, here's our machine learning model, then we, just by looking at it, we may get a better understanding of our business. Maybe the correlation or the patterns that the machine learning model has uncovered are beneficial to us. And maybe we can take our machine learning model, put an API around it, and start using it in our application. Make our application smarter, because it can now make use of the machine learning model. When our user types three characters, we already know what they want, and we can add all the information that otherwise would have had to type in. Maybe. And maybe we can use our machine learning model in doing better data wrangling, so improving the quality of our data set. Because we can throw out anomalies that really just shouldn't be there, that will spoil the data set, for example. So what do we do it with? Well, with math. And I'm sure you would like to spend the last 15 minutes of today, apart from the aperitivo, to discuss math, wouldn't you? Well, I wouldn't. Everything you've seen, all the statistics, everything I've sort of talked about with machine learning in the end is based on math. You don't need to know any math in order to make use of it. So we're not going to discuss math anymore. Some of the technologies that you could be using, that you don't have to use, are listed here. So your data pipeline, where you get data from the raw data sources and bring it into the data warehouse or the data lake, these are some of the common technologies that are used for that, including SQL, including Python, a lot of Python. And to store data, here are some of the common technologies. Oracle would like you to use the Oracle Autonomous Data Warehouse Cloud, which is basically a managed Oracle database cloud, the advanced analytics option, and the number of facilities that make it easy to manage your data warehouse. And for data wrangling, there's a number of technologies you could be using. For small-scale data wrangling, I don't think anything beats Jupyter Notebooks using Python. I started doing it only a few months ago, and I love it. It's fun doing it, and it gets you meaningful results. That's what I used for the first step of the Oracle Open World data analysis. Oracle Analytics Cloud also supports data wrangling to some extent. I will hopefully be able to show that later on. For reporting and visualizing, these are some of the common technologies. Some of it are from Oracle, some of it are open source, some of it are from other vendors. Tableau, for example, is a well-known technology, well-known tool. And for machine learning, here are some of the technologies that you could be using. Again, some from Oracle, some from other vendors, many from the open source domain. I'm not saying you should be using one, certainly not saying you should be using all of it. You could be using some of it, you could find your own technologies as well. But likely you will be using some of these. So when you take a look at the Oracle Cloud Services, this is what Oracle has to offer for the data flow pipeline I was talking about. Here's data management, here's the data pipeline and the data wrangling, and over there is the business intelligence, the presentation, the visualization. There's also business intelligence and data visualization on its own, and that's a bit confusing. Those are the old products that have been brought to the cloud, but are really still the old products, like OBIE, Oracle Business Intelligence Enterprise Edition. If you're going to do this for the first time, don't touch the Business Intelligence Cloud, use the Analytics Cloud. So the data flow, according to Oracle, should look something like this. Here you've got your data sources using Data Integration Platform Cloud, which contains, or at least functionality that we know from tools like Oracle Data Integrator and Oracle Golden Gate. Load your data in the Autonomous Data Warehouse Cloud, potentially also in Big Data Cloud, and Big Data Cloud can also be populated from other directions. Here is unstructured data. In the Autonomous Data Warehouse Cloud is structured data. It's a relational database, although, of course, it can hold JSON, XML, and even plain text. And then Oracle Analytics Cloud can use both Autonomous Data Warehouse Cloud and the Big Data Cloud as its source. It could use many other data sources as well, like a Mongo database, Elasticsearch, a file system. It can use many different data sources, but at least it can use these two. And with Oracle Analytics Cloud, you can do many different things. Preparing the data, wrangling the data, presenting the data, and also machine learning. I'll skip this slide. It gives you more detail about Autonomous Data Warehouse Cloud. Skip this as well. This is a nice overview of Oracle Analytics Cloud. But again, we don't really have time for this. It's marketing slides. Take a look at it afterwards. Oracle's also working on a what it's for the Data Science Lab, a cloud service that's called the Data Science Platform Cloud. And that's not available yet. It will be launched in a few months' time. And it will really be for the data scientists. It will allow them to collaborate using notebooks, Jupyter notebooks, or other notebooks. Other than that, it isn't really adding anything. Okay. Take a brief look at how we do data collection and data wrangling with Oracle Analytics. Here's my data source, or here's the front end to my data source. So this is a website which gives an overview of all the sessions at Oracle Open World and at Code One. And it's intended for humans. It's not programmatic, it's just a user interface. And here's some of the information you can get for a session. And over there, the little arrow indicates that slides are available for download or not. If it's missing, then there are no slides for download. So I thought I would have to resort to scraping the website. And scraping is basically writing a program that downloads a web page as if you are a human user, and then trying to interpret whatever is shown on the page. But fortunately, turns out that this page uses a backend REST API. And I can invoke that same REST API because there's no authorization or authentication on it. And then I get my data in a JSON-style format. Here is a representation of the JSON, and it's pretty raw. There's a lot of attributes I can't use or I don't understand. And there is some data that I think I need, but not in the current shape. So this is my raw source, but it's clearly not good enough. So the raw source is over there, an API that I I can invoke, and I can extract all the information about sessions in JSON format. And then I'm data gathering, I start data wrangling, and then I can start doing my business intelligence and find out whether Grant was correct or I was right. And I could do some machine learning. I would like to be able to classify sessions based on the title and abstract in a certain track. You may know how all sessions are assigned to a track, the database track or the business intelligence track. I would like to see whether I can use text analysis to do so. So this first step I did using Python and Jupyter Notebook, because it's easier than using Analytics Cloud. Quickly fiddling with the data set, there are thousands, if not tens of thousands, of Python libraries that you can use for this, including the assigned gender based on first name library. And there are so many examples and resources. I think about 20% of the posts on Stack Overflow are about Python, and almost 11% are about notebooks. There's a lot of information. So that was a very simple first step. I turned my data, my JSON data, in many different files. I turned it into one big CSV file, and that I could upload to, well, I could upload it to Autonomous Data Warehouse Cloud. I can also upload it to Oracle Analytics Cloud, or I can start working on it on the Data Visualization Desktop Edition. And then by the time I've really prepared the data set and I've started to do some visualization, I want to start to do some visualization, I can use Analytics Cloud, and also for doing machine learning, I can use Analytics Cloud. So in slightly more detail, here's my raw data processed in the Jupyter Notebook, resulting in a CSV file. Here I've uploaded the CSV file into both Analytics Cloud and Data Visualization Desktop. I will show that in a moment. And here I'm creating a data flow that joins the data that I've uploaded from the CSV file with data I'm downloading or fetching from a MongoDB cloud database. That's happening over here, the join, and that gives me a new data set. Over there, you can see the various machine learning activities that I can also add to the data flow. So for example, time series forecast or analyze sentiment are steps that I can insert in this data flow to use to further improve my data set before creating the visualizations. Like I said, my son could do it if I instructed him where to click and what to drag. With this data set, I start to create my visualizations. You've seen these before. Here are the data elements. I can drag and drop the data elements. I have to specify what type of visualization would I like to use, and that's basically it. After I have created a number of visualizations on canvases, I can create my final presentation, the thing I want to present to management, or to Grant, or to you. And this this narration can be annotated as well. So I can add markers on the visual to point at specific values and to explain specific values, as you saw me do over here. And then there's the Data Visualization Desktop. The cloud has landed. It's a desktop tool. It can integrate with Excel, so you can take data in an Excel sheet and just publish it to the Data Visualization Desktop. It has on-par functionality with Analytics Cloud. It's single user. It has limited resources. You are bound by whatever your laptop can do, and it's free. And at any point in time, you can either export a project from Analytics Cloud and import it into Data Visualization Desktop, or the other way around. We're almost out of time, so to give you a very, very quick overview, this is the desktop. And in the desktop, I can look at various data sets, data flows, and connections. Here are, for example, the connections to my Cloud Mongo database, the data sets, and here are the data flows. And here's the data flow I was just talking about. I take a CSV file, I take the data from the Mongo database, and I join them together based on venue short. Apparently, both data sets have an attribute called venue short. If that's the same, then I have a match. And I could add additional steps from this palette. including sentiment analysis, including time series prediction. Here's a project. In the project, I can prepare the data, visualize the data, and create the narration. Visualize, here's an example. I can create a new canvas, an empty canvas. On this empty canvas, I can, for example, drop gender. Well, it doesn't really help me. And I can then add session count. Should add it over here. This is not much of a visualization, but it gives you an indication of how fast you can bring things together. I can then try to turn it into, does it make a meaningful pie chart? And gender for color as well. So there we go. 74% of the sessions was presented by a male presenter, 13% by a female presenter, and for almost 14% we don't know. Again, it's not extremely meaningful, but it's just to give you a taste of how easy it is to take your prepared data set, wrangled and all, drag it onto the canvas, and create a visualization from it. And I can try other types of visualization if I think they make sense. And I have to drag, well, I could drag, that's not going to help, I guess. That's. Now I'm adding the job title. No, it's not interpreting it as a job title. Never mind. This is going into too much detail. You can very easily take your data, create visualizations. That's the main takeaway. So in summary, we all know data contains a lot of value. Data is the new oil, data is the new gold, data is everything. Well, that might be true. But you don't necessarily get the value from the data just like that. You have to go to a very structured process. And in that process, you are gathering data, preparing the data, or wrangling. If you want to do machine learning, you will have to train and test and train and test and go through many iterations before you probably have a meaningful trained machine learning model. And you have to visualize the data, to present the data to people in a way that gets the value from the data into the heads of the people that are interpreting it. That's not so simple either. That might be a different job than ours, by the way. But we have to, we probably have to be the ones that make the data just right for the business intelligence people and the data scientists. So Oracle's data analytics portfolio supports this quite well. I like Jupyter Notebooks, and that will, for the time being, be my first port of call. But once I get to the more intricate data wrangling and the more advanced data visualization and the more specific machine learning, I will turn to maybe Autonomous Warehouse Cloud. I have not really tried it out yet, but it has the data mining capabilities in it. That might be interesting. Big Data Cloud, specifically Analytics Cloud. But if you're interested, you can start with the free data visualization desktop. And in a few months' time, the data science platform. I think it's time for an aperitivo now. Thank you very much. Grazie.